Moti sa fun ma ma mi wi pe ma de lo ni o a jo yo wi pe ma de lo ni o mo ma ti so fun awon ebi mi wi pe ma de lo ni a jo yo Oklahoma o mo de ti so fa won re mi o wi pe ma de lo ni o a jo yo e o wi pe ma de lo ni fa won okunrin obirin wi pe ma de lo
Thank you all for coming out. Guys, this is a lot of huge people to be out here today, and it's an honor to have all of you around. So I'm going to say one thing is that I don't know what she has told you, but one thing I have to say is that this is me, and this is Olani, but not this. So I'm sure many people always ask me where that name comes from. So that first thing I'm going to say is where that name comes from. It comes from here, and it comes from this. It's always difficult because we mostly in Africa, you have almost like lot of names they'll give to you. So, and these names comes from different reasons, different purpose. Your uncle, your sisters, your aunties, everybody, grandparents, grandpapa, grandmama, family friends, they will give you different names. And also as an artist, you want to sign some names on your work, which everybody needs to. So it gave me a long deal to find which of the names I want to sign. While I was in school, it's always difficult. I find people signing, artists who will sign the same first name, which I used to sign, so I stopped signing it. The middle name, the same. Although I've not seen my family name be signed. So as an artist, I think there's always something you are looking for. So I started abbreviate names. I started using it. But most of funniest about it is that people love that one. And in 99, I went to Japan to do a residency. And I come to find out the meaning of that name. Sometimes when people first hear the name, they have a way that they thought maybe I'm related to Asian countries without seeing my face first. So when I found out, I met an old man who told me, do you know the meaning of your name? I said, no. I said, I just form it for my name. He said, your name means unique one. And then he now related it to Kirashi, Rashima, and co, and then started dividing that name. And then now finally, let me understand how that name, what it really means. But I think that is not why we are here. I'm going to tell you more about my work. I use a lot of materials. I love to experiment. And some people used to say, I have a friend who used to say, Akira, I should like to gamble. And I say, well, if you say I'd like to gamble, it's fine. It's a way of describing it. Because the reason is because sometimes when I pick materials, I don't know what it's going to be, what it's going to come up over. But the idea was that I like to see the process of that work and then see what it's going to finally become. So most of the time when it becomes something, even if I don't satisfy with it, I guess the process helped me to see what and how I can turn it over. So during some of the works you are going to see, are going to see works which is more sculptures, installations, which is going to be more mixed media paintings, and then you are going to see materials from plastic, paper, metals, wood, and any other things which I think I've loved to have across on the road and use. When you read this, it tells you what my work is mostly based on. What inspired me? What did I work through? What are the things that really motivate me to do my work? I think I love something which is like moment. I love something which is time and the present, environment, the places, the people, where we are, where we are living, what is going on with us. If it is like I'm coming here for a residency, which I'm not ready to do the work already and come here, let's say I'm going to spend a month. My first 2 weeks or 1 week and a half week is to go into everywhere in this still water. I want to mingle with people, both night and days, to see what they do, how they behave, what they like, what are the situation of the city. So with that, then I have the chances to start creating something. Why did I used to do that? The idea to do that was because most of the times when you go on the street, you see sculptures or you see artworks. People just walk by. And my question that I always ask myself is, why people never take note of these works? It's because those works does not relate to them. They don't have anything that connect them with it. But if we try all the time to commission works which community which that work is going to be planned or put into, they are involved in the beginning of that commission, I guess most of the time they take care of it, it becomes part of them. In 2008, I was in residence in Art Institute in Chicago. And then I look at that moment of like, it's mostly, I think it's around summer. And then one day I was in the Millennium Park, and I saw a man riding. A wife was sitting behind, and then they have their baby in front. So I was looking, and I said, wow, that is cool. So I said, okay. Then I started collecting the bottle plastics. Then I have to create sculptures which really mount that. So during my performance with the student in the Millennium Park that time, then we installed this at the same time, then we did the performance. This I call it back to school. I did this in 2008. It was shown first in France, then it's also in Germany, that is in Cologne, in Germany, and it was shown in Accra, and it was finally collected by Belgium government embassy in Accra at the time. And this also using the plastic bottles, which created people or kids, like sitting down and then going to school. And this comes from me when I went to India, and the way people, like you see the kids doesn't have a school or classroom. They sit down outside or under the trees and go and be schooling, which also relates to some of part of Africans which I've ever visited, that some of them does not have schools, building like blocks or any other things, but they sit under the trees to learn. Then I try to relate both those places to where I am coming from or where what I've ever seen. This I call it fry pan to fire. This look into migration of, I know these days, if you have been reading newspaper, you can hear of a lot of a disaster by the young ones who are traveling through the Mediterranean Sea, and most of the people from Asia and Israel and Co. who are trying to cross the border into the Europe. So this, I use this bottle to create a kind of a boat. But this is just for you to see the process, and before we see the main boat. So this is how, when it was installed. And as I said, I enjoy using materials. If any of you could recognize this, this is a disket, which many does not know about it or didn't use it. I remember when I first showed it, many questions come up, like, because I feel art is not about a kind of classes of people. It should be open to anybody, even the young ones. And it's also a kind of a memory for people to see what has gone before they are born or for the future generation. And you can see a lot of kids ask me questions, what is that? Where does that come from? I know kind of this. No, don't be laughed. It is true. Because in their era, it is CD, memory stick. And that also will soon go away. That is very sure, because technology grow. You are all here. You are creating. The kind of buildings that they are building now, I'm sure you want to build, you want to design something else crazy. Then with that, we have to remove all this building to suit what you are going to design in your own time. So this is how it changes. This is a slide also which I collected, which I put together and becomes a fabric. And this, when you have, the first time I show it, you have to shoot a light behind it, and then you can see all the images on the wall and on the floor. This, I did this in 2012. I was in South Africa, in Johannesburg. And I think one morning I was going and I saw this bunch. There is a second-hand market. So on that morning I saw all this hanger, the plastic hanger, they put it in a box. And I was like, what is that? Then I stand there for like an hour because I was thinking, should I carry all of this? And if you carry it, what am I going to do with it? How will I use it? And at the same time I was like, okay, I can't take it back to the state. It's going to be heavy finishing about it. Because that is one of the things that really, really stop we artists to create. You are afraid of, if I do it big, how can I ship it, and those kind of things. So it limits on how you create. You want to create very small, very small. It comes to a time I made a lot of sketches. I have a bunch of sketches, and I never do them. Why? Because I always think, okay, where will I put them? Who's going to take it, or who's going to acquire it? But it comes to a time that I have to get rid of that fear, and I start doing it. Then it comes to a time, then they are being collected. So I think it's a stage which you are going to get there. So this also, I found this in a mechanic garage. It's also, I did it also in Johannesburg, in the same, when I was doing the kind of residency also there. The residence was called Bag Factory. It is collaborating with a Triangle Art. You can go to your website and Google Triangle Art or Triangle Art Association or something like that. They have the link almost maybe half of the world. You have the chances to go to that, to do that residence or do that workshop, but it's competitive. But why do we say competitive? I think it's a way to let you prove that you are also good. So these letters is not something that they gave to me that, yes, you should use it. It's the letter that I found. But the idea was that how can I use them to create a kind of a word and make meaningful when you see any of the side together. This work, it's work which I did in Austin. And it took me, I would say, maybe 2.5 years to do it. Why? Because this plastic spoon, the fork, the knife, I didn't buy them. I collect them from restaurants. So it's collecting them as we're working on them gradually. So after finishing them, this is what it becomes. And the size of that work is 7 feet tall and 35 feet wide. And as I said, I told you that I enjoy experimenting materials, working with different materials. This is a mechanic, a vehicle's headlights and backlights and cool, which I collect together and then try to make sculptures out of it. And this is also part of the works which I use plastic spoons and fork and knives, which I collected together. So this is like this process of, the first thing I did was when I collect them, I wash the clean all of them, remove all the oil out. Then I try to spray colors on them to just change the face of it before I start punching them or drill them and start sewing them together with copper wire. So you can see the process when I was working on it. And that is the bottoms of it. And that is when it is finally installed. This is also materials which you are familiar with, even if maybe you didn't use the VHC video cassette, which is also materials, which I do. This was one of the work. It's acquired in Adelaide in Australia. This is in Germany now. It's in a city called Kiel. So this is also like going into the mechanic workshops and start collecting a lot of scraps from engine and other things like that. And then the idea was you have to wash them all from oil and then start sewing them together with wire gradually and gradually to form something. And this I call it Bend Down Boutique. Bendan Boutique, I did this project, I think I have 56 of it, which is from different parts of cloth. The shoes, the hair cap, the bra, the brassiere, the blouse, the skirt, in different form, but from different kind of the same materials. And this is also another, which is, this one is a Christmas tree, so. And this was made out of newspapers. A lot of newspaper cut them into different materials. This work now is a new work which is installed now in Texas State University in St. Marcos. If you Google them, you will find it on their website now. It's they just installed. I think it's, the show was open last three weeks. So, and this is the complete of it, why it's been, how it was installed. But this is how finally it is installed in their gallery. So that is a slide. So at the same time, the light was shoot in, and then you can see a lot of all these images on the floor of the gallery. And this also like working with a lot of boxes which we throw out of our house. I guess the idea of this come when you go into the grocery store, you can see how those things was being arranged, like nicely arranged, just like you're working inside the library and see the books, the way it is arranged. This work has gone to, is as at this moment is in Amsterdam now on a show, and then I think next week is coming back, and October 16 is going to be shown also again in Dallas. I don't know if you have ever heard of what they call Aurora. It's a new media program which is just one night, and it's always a crazy one. I know the first one I attended was in New York and also in Berlin. But it's for 2 years now, they've been starting doing it in Dallas, which is all about video, lighting, art, and different kind of sculptures and performance. And it starts right from the 7 p.m. in the evening to 2 a.m. in the night. And they see that Dallas is always turned to something else at that night. And it's free, it's open. And you go from one place to the other, and you enjoy yourself to see a lot of art. And it's just that moment, and everything's gone. And this is one work which I did, which also look into the casket was, I mean, the coffin was made out of boxes, but when you look at it, you think maybe it is wood or this. No, it is box, and it's just the paint that changed the face of it. And the collections of other things that is there is just the plastic guns. And the idea was to look at the issue of gun violence, which is a rampart all over the world. And this has been shown in, I think the last show was the 16th country. So the idea when I created it was I'm trying to see if possibly it could go all over the world, even possibly in any city we want it, ready to come and show it. So last year, this is one of the ones, I showed this, I displayed it in different form in New York. This is a collection of photos which I found. I just found the box. I think they threw it out. And I collect them, I bring them to my studio, I start cutting them into pieces, and I start putting them together. Then I start weaving all together. So after weaving it, and that does not stop, then I move it to to another level. With this, when you see it, these are like details, and this is what it becomes finally. So that's why I said work is all about process. And you should not be afraid of taking it to wherever you feel your heart desire. These are made out of paper pipes. Some of the paper pipes you buy from carpet, from your papers and other things. So I just collect them and cut them and then pin them. Then it's more about, this one is more about political. So and this, I did this in New York in a residence, one of those residences I told you about, Triangle Art. And the idea was this, a necktie, which I collected on the street. So I tried to like first sew them together with needles and thread, and it becomes a whole cloth. So I start cutting them into pieces, just like you see them. Then I start weaving again, just as you see the process there. Then it goes to this, then it finally comes into that. And that finally comes to this. This is a new work, which I call it Infinity. What I did was to collect a lot of, you know, some of you are sleeping at home, you have a feather pillow or feather blanket or feather. So most of those feather, when you people throw them away, I decided to just start collecting them and then start working with it. So most of this, what you see at the background, they are all feathers. But then I start to build bed houses, and then trying to see, because the idea was I'm trying to take it to the next level or move it to different thing to see how or what it could really becomes. So this is what it becomes. This is the details, and that is what is it. So in it, there is a video which I did of the bed when they are like flying and moving and kind of a movement. So. Anybody recognize this? Anybody know what that is? I've purposely left that one there without painting it. Anybody know it?
Peanut
shells. So the idea, as I told you, they are all around you. It's just how do you want to use them? And this, I did 3,000 of it. Last week again, I work on it, I did another 500. Because I have a show in Dallas at the University of Dallas, University of Texas in Dallas, which I'm going to show it in the next 2 weeks. As I said, I love to work with students. This and other students. And then you see where what we did during the process of working together. This is the first one we created, and then we move away, we move again. And then now we create that also. And that building, nobody has ever done anything. And the funniest thing about even that big country is it, they've never had any sculptures put on the wall or put outside in this form. And this really creates a lot of talk that gave me another two great offer or commission from this work alone. They are fabulous people, those guys. We work throughout the night. Sometimes I ask them to go home, they'll say no. Sometimes I went to the house to sleep, I come back there in the studio. I said, what are you guys, what are you doing? That is because there's something they are searching for. So. And that is what finally that becomes. As I said, I love using papers. And the paper, what I do was that I'll fold them and I'll cut them into pieces and form like So it takes me back to my school or study of textile. That I don't want it to also look like just textile, but I'm looking for something which is beyond just textile. But when you see it, the first thing that comes into your mind is that is fabric. So what I did was to cut the shape of those paper into people, like small, small, small people, and then start putting them together one by one to form fabric. I think I forgot a question from one of my work, which is also done from this. And then the students want to know what size it is. All these are made the beginning of their papers, and they are cut into pieces one by one, and then start putting them together. This one is 8 by 8 feet, and the same thing, I think this also is 8 by 8 feet. And that loom was created, was fabricated from a second-hand piano key, the hammer, where you see. But most of the time, when you put your legs on it, after I design it, it will be moving all those paper front and back, as if it's weaving, just like a loom. So I guess we are in the era of performances, and most of the times I create costumes, a lot of costumes, to go with whatever I want to do. Thank you. She wants to know if textile is something which, as my background, where if she saw some of the works that I love, weavings or incorporate graphics inside in the middle of it. So the only thing I would say is that, well, my great grandparents, they weave. She weave a lot. And she used a lot, she do a lot of tying and dyeing. And those days, most of what they do was to extract colors from the roots of trees. They will boil them, they will extract colors from leaves, and they will use it to dye cloth. They will fold them, twist them with ropes, raffia ropes. They will tie it with stones in it and form different kind of forms when you put it in. And when you remove those ropes, they form different shapes. This, I know of it. This, I saw her doing it, even though I'm very, very small at that time. So, but that, I don't know I'm going to be artist or do art or any other things. But I always say that something always come back to you or you go back to it in one way or the other. But I think I love Tester. I love that integrate of it and the message and the things that it talks about and how it is. And I see it like kind of a secret that protects we human beings. We all wear it, either we wear it short or wear it long. We use it to protect ourselves. So, and that is one of the reasons why I cut most of those paper into the shape of people and then start putting them together. Sometimes when you see me putting them together, because the size of it, the long of it is just like maybe 1.5 inches, and then the wide maybe like 0.5 inches. Then I'm going to put all of them together, even if it's going to be 20 feet wide. So it's going to be that way and that way till it comes to that. But also something all these worry people about is that they feel, the first person who collected was like, is it not going to break because it's paper, it's not going to do this. Then he saw me, I take the work and I squeeze everything together and I put it on the floor and I step it. And I asked him, okay, take it and he spread it out. Then he spread it out, he said, wow. Then he said, you know, just leave it the way it is wrinkled. I like it that way. Can we install it that way in my, say, why not? So I think that is one of the things, because sometimes the collector wants to test you in one way or the other. They want to see how confident you are with what you are selling to them. And I always say that anything you create, they want to see that smile in it, even though you are not present in there. But it's there, because immediately they see that work, they see that life, that happiness in it. And that's one thing you also want to, because when you see people see work and they start looking at it, or they kind of see the face, their faces, it tells you what that goes into the mind and the faces of that artist or whoever you created those works. So textile is something which it's a little bit of my background. And when you go to Africa, you see a lot of old women weaving on the loom. And they weave in stripes. And when they weave in stripes, they start putting them together. So the idea of those comes more from those kind of things white people weave. And from textile, I think I've traveled to some countries, went to India to see people weaving. I've been to Mexico to see how they weave in those traditional and those kind of things. So different countries that I will see how I could learn from those things and try to incorporate them into my work. What she was asking is a kind of a debate. I've heard of it. That is something which I've listened to, or I've been in a conversation or kind of a talk that comes out with some artists or artists there. I think the idea was that people want to know that most of the artists maybe generate from Africa or who have a link to Africa use a lot of scraps or a lot of materials which are found or something which is scraps, and also look into like topic of poverty or something like that. I would say yes and no. One thing is this, I guess maybe in Africa there is a lot which in the past people are not so much voiced out. They are so much afraid of dictative of maybe government or whoever, what is it. And even at those days of olden days, it's about the king ruling. You have to follow, no question to ask. So as democracy or whatever comes into the life, it gradually tends to change. And then art also changed, because those days, if you're carving, you don't carve for anybody. You carve only for the kings. You carve for the chiefs. The art you do is only for those people. You don't just carve that anybody could have it. But in this era, anybody can have art now. You can buy it, you can own it, you can have it. So I think those are part of the voices where you find in those materials. And one thing again that I think most, for me, I was saying this morning that I started using waste materials because I don't have money. If you want to be a student of art, not to lie, it's expensive. Materials might kick you out. But if you have strong head that you want to do it, you need to find a way out. And I find a way out by creating my own brushes, by creating my own paint. And that is how it links me back into what I do today, or be confident in using waste materials. So, because I remember when I finished my bachelor as biochemistry, I worked for 2 years in a pharmacy company. I have money, I have everything. But one day, I decided to switch back to art. In the culture that we have, it's like some spirit is worrying into your, is disturbing your head, or somebody is like throwing something, or you are losing your mind. So none of my family really agree with that. Now, how will you live that? A lot of kids are looking up to you, that you finish your university, you have degree, and then you are working good work, and then you are going to dump it and say you are going to do art. Because their mind at those days, when you see artists, they don't respect them. They feel like they are trash people. They don't have the money or the courage or to do something to take care of their family. But one thing that gave me the strength was to prove to them, to prove to people which doesn't know that art is beyond what they have in mind. And I think in my life, in my little career, I've been able to prove to many people about that. That is a different art, and it's a different how you can take it to next level. So if I answer your questions, that you want to know if I approach my performance different from when I do paintings or mixed media or sculptures or installations. Sometimes I allow two of them or three of them or four of them to come together into one piece. Sometimes I create mixed media painting, and I create an installation sculptures. And I sometimes I do video together with it. Then I will perform in that opening to go with everything. And all of them are speaking and looking at. The idea was this. That question people asked me one time, why do you do performance now? Why you always paint before, you do sculpture alone before? The reason why I do this is because we understand art more than each other. Somebody, when they see painting, it's enough for them to get crazy over it, learn from it, and understand it, and communicate directly with them. Some people, it is installations. Some people, it's sculptures. But the idea, as I told you, if you're an artist, I believe that you shouldn't be able afraid of any part of department of art. You should be able to face it. If it is painting, it's ceramics, it's sculptures, it's video, you should be able to try your best to make it happen. It's an easy thing to do. It is a way of just training yourself into it. So I think that is exactly what I do. I don't always approach them in different form, but they always sometimes link, or it may be in different topic. If that answers your question. You want to know if when I design or when I write a project, if I'm always thinking of collaborative with that work, or I just decide that this work needs collaboration. Every work, if I have to do it with community, or do it in a community, or I go for a residence in a country which I don't live or I don't know, I try to make sure that people in there are involved one way or the other. They might not like put their hands in it, but they will collaborate in one way or the other, like maybe interview them or getting to know them or see what is going on and mingle with them, eat with their family, play with them, because I'm taking something from them. That is also another collaborative. It doesn't mean that they have to put their hands in my paint, no. But if it involves universities, that students are involved, the truth is this, you love it or not, it's good for you as a student to be part of that. It's an experience, because that is a chance that the school gives to you to invite a visiting artist to come into your school or come closer to your environment and give you the chances to meet that person one-on-one. You pay money, to tell you the fact, I pay money to have work with artists which I respect. Because you have to fix time, you have to do this. In Austin, most of the UT students in there, it's always a lineup. Because the idea was not because of any, because they want to learn something. Because it's a different thing when you are in school. And when you work with artists or you see how artists, the process they do, you help them in their studio, it shapes how you create. It shapes how you think and how they go about something, because you are going to become that thing. You are coming to become that. Then, and if you leave school, if you don't know those steps, it's going to really, 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 really be a big problem. Because it's a different thing when you are in school. Maybe you do your assignment, you do all the work your professor tells you, but it's a different steps when you are out into that world. It's very, very tough competition, and especially in the country we are living. If you ever go to New York City, 6 p.m. in the evening, that is when the exhibition starts opening. And I'm telling you, you will go through that, like that, like that, like that, from one gallery to the other, till the morning. And I'm telling you, you go back to your house, you ask yourself, oh God, what did I see today? You are going to see crazy work. And that will turn your head. You will be like, ask yourself, if you are an artist, I'm not doing anything. And if you are opening a show now, the journalists are here, the people are here, everybody here, that you are celebrating that, yeah, I've been working for 2 years and this is all the set of the works I've been doing. The question they are going to ask you, what is next? So it tells you that, what are you jubilating over? What are you celebrating? So it means that when you present one set of work as an exhibition now, you must have another set up something for like 2-3 sets in different places. Last week, I have 2 shows opening.
and I was in a residence, and I must make sure that those works are set and is there. Even if I'm not present at the opening, it's good that the technology is there. You can Skype while they are opening. They are Skyping with me. I'm in my studio. I'm working and I'm looking and I'm talking, and they are opening the show. So with that, this is part of what I'm saying, that you can't be everywhere, but it's a kind of competition in your head which you need to prepare for. It's always going to be there. So collaborative work with people, I love it. Because for me, as I said, you are teaching me something. Because you are bringing something in. Though I may also give something out, because that is what is it, what is the take. It is give and take. So that is why I said, if you collaborate with a project, you have the chances to use that project in any way. And that artist will sign for you, will write a letter of reference for you if they request for it, because they want to ask you which part of that project, no matter how big it is, and no matter how small, if it is this, they will ask you, which part is it? Oh, this is the part that I work with. And they will ask you, who is the artist that you work with this? They may ask you, who are the other students of school or something that work with you? Then you need to mention them. They will send questions to them. So if you lied, then you are in trouble. So these are part of things you should understand in kind of a, when you are collaborating with people.